going to be working with Mr. Roper again. You might remember him from being scared of a hose. A couple little housekeeping things before I get started here. You got a round pen. You got a gate. You bring horses out here to work, and what's on both sides of this gate? Star sisal. It pokes and it hurts. And so when a horse leaves and comes in, he scratches his legs and he gets poked with star sisal. And what better way to teach a horse to dislike a round pen if every time he walks in it? It'd be like every time he walks in a round pen, you shock him. Pretty soon he figures out, when I go to the round pen, I get shocked. I don't like the round pen, therefore I'm going to resist. I'm going to fight. I'm going to get ready every time I go in there. This is one of those things that, you know, you end up teaching a horse a bad lesson by just not being practical. Do you want to rub through that every time you walk through? Of course you don't. Humans don't walk through that. They'll push their horse in it, but they won't walk through it because it hurts their legs and it sticks the horse's legs. So if you see something like this around your round pen, you don't want a horse associating a negative area with getting stuck. Okay, now if I had a fence area that horses were leaning on and I had star sisal growing, I'd leave it. Because I don't want them leaning on a fence, and when they get over there or when they lean on a fence, I want them to get stuck. But when I'm going in a round pen or an area to work, I don't want stickers, so I don't want them getting stuck. And another thing that I saw out here, to where another non-horse person that doesn't think like a horse comes out here, oh, I'll fix the round pen. This round pen is kind of leaning. So I'll put a steel pipe on the inside of the round pen, so when a horse runs by, if he clips his leg, he's going to cut it. And it's hitting him with a bush, and now we got a steel pipe. Now I got to ask myself, how can a person not say, you know what? If I'm going to tie this thing to the pipe anyway, why can't I put it on the outside where the horse ain't going to run into it, where it doesn't have these sharp edges, and a horse isn't going to cut himself? Why don't I put this pipe on the outside and tie this pole? To me, that's just straight up, simple, basic, common sense. Yet somebody came out here trying to fix this pipe, and somebody's going to be like, oh, Rick, well, they were just trying to help. They didn't know. You ain't helping when you hurt a horse. You're not helping when you do things that set a horse up to cut his leg or to break his leg when he runs by there and gets skipped, or he spins on a turn and hits his nose and cuts his nose open or breaks a tooth. Okay? This would have been so simple to put on the outside. Yet somebody probably owned horses their whole lives going to come out here and fix the fence and put a metal pipe on the inside and tie the pole instead of putting it on the outside where the horse can't hurt himself. Okay? I sometimes people just amaze me. Anyway, all right, that's let's get back to horse training. I got a whip out of here. Mr. Roper came in here. Now, I've been helping the owner with this horse a little bit, and I worked with the hose, and that's the last time I worked with him. And I told her to get rid of this crappy halter. Like, oh, that's not a halter. Look at those nice snaps, Rick. That's a good halter. This is a crappy halter, okay? It's flat. It's got a band. The horse doesn't feel it. It teaches a horse to pull. It's got a snap that'll break. It's got all these buckles that'll get caught. It's got a fancy brass buckle to make it easy for the human to unhook it, which will get a horse caught. Or if another horse comes up and rubs on him, he'll end up scratching himself. A snap is the first thing to break on a halter. You got this cheap nylon rope that'll burn the crap out of your hands because it's not cotton. You can't hang on to it, and if you try, it'll burn your hands. So let's get the worst halter with the roast rope with a bunch of buckles when we know that we have a horse that likes to pull, okay? And now I've told the people, look, you need to get a good rope halter. You need a rope. Hey, Hollywood, what are you doing? You want to come in here and get beat up? So I brought my rope halter out here. And again, it's Clinton Anderson. Got a couple knots on it. No buckles. A rope. Good, soft yacht line rope, which is good rope. It's made to absorb salt because it's made to work in the ocean, so the horse's sweat isn't going to weaken it. It's got a good soft cotton lining. It's very flexible. It's easy to tie. It's not stiff, and it's strong as can be. So anytime I buy horse rope, I go to a selling shop online, and I get some good sail line that's cotton lined and that's strong. And that's what you need to get for you tying your horses and working with your horses. So, you know, when you try and help people, I try to tell people things. You need to do this, you need to do that. Well, they pick and choose what they want to do. Well, this is easy, so I'll go ahead and listen to Rick on this. But this is just too much trouble, or I don't want to go buy another you know, had you bought a rope halter, it would have been cheaper than that fancy black thing anyway. It would have been better, last longer, and it would have taught your horse better lessons, and you're going to keep your horse forever. That rope halter is going to wear out. If you take the time it takes less time. I'll see people buy 4 different rope halters that are cheap. Buddy, get over here. Buddy! Boy, I'm going to beat that horse in a minute. He knows I'm talking on his phone, so now he figures he can make his escape out that gate and head to the barn. So when you buy rope halters, I see people that'll buy 4 rope halters, and they'll be cheap, and they'll cost them $10 each, but they got a good deal by buying a $10 rope halter, and they'll go through 4 halters in a year or two. When they could have bought, I've got this Clinton Anderson halter that I've had for 10 years, and it works fine, and I've had it on more horses than most people are ever going to put on a horse, and it's been pulled, and it works fine. And it's expensive. It costs a lot more than $10, Rick. I can't afford that. Well, if you take the time it takes, and he's got that rope around his leg, which is really good. He walked in there, so hopefully he'll give a little spook here when he walks off, or he'll drag it. So I'm gonna go catch Buddy and beat him in a minute, Buddy. So all right, let's get back to working out with this horse. Because I haven't worked with it with a hose, and all the owners have done is take him in and out of the stall and let him go out. He come out here, and of course I had their halter on him, and he went and pulled and got his butt to me and turned away and pulled away. And so I had to go catch him, and he got away, and it's like, you know what, horses get away, they're going to get away, but they shouldn't learn to get away. And had I had a good rope halter on him with a nice rope that I could have hung on to, he wouldn't have got away, and he wouldn't have learned that he could get away. Now, he's been getting away from the owner, so he's learned that he can get away, so he's going to try that. So with him, you're going to have to keep, boy, I'm going to go get that horse. Buddy! I'm at 8 minutes. I'll be done here in a minute. Then I'll do another one. Real quick on a whip. He was scared of a whip. I'm rubbing him. There's a thing out there where people want to work with a bamboo stick on a horse. The new thing is, oh, bamboo training on a horse. You get a bamboo stick. It's an extension of your arm. You could touch the horse. You could desensitize him. Well, that's all true, but there's a couple things where people make mistakes. He's dragging that rope right between his feet. See there? You know, people, I just did a video on drunk driving in a, I guess I'm at 7 minutes, not 8. I just did a video on drunk driving and a divided attention and talking about different things and how it's harder to react. When I'm doing these videos, a lot of times I'll say left when I mean right, or I'll use words that really are kind of opposite. And I listen to it later, I go, what the hell was I thinking? I'm trying to keep this horse in this video. I'm watching Buddy get into trouble. I'm trying to explain and keep my thoughts, and I'm watching this horse drag this rope, waiting for a reaction to make sure I'm not in his way. So I am multitasking on a lot of different levels, and that makes my reaction time, that makes what I'm saying, my thought process slower. And all that happens to horsemen when they're on horses and they don't know when they're worried about rein control, etc., like we've talked about. But back to the bamboo stick. An extension of your arm, you can use a whip, a bamboo stick, a tree branch, a pole. You can use any of these things, kind of like as an extension, to keep you at a safe distance to desensitize a horse. I want to see if this horse is going to stomp when I rub it on his leg. I want to see if he's going to freak out when I stick it between his front legs. I want to see if he's going to kick when I rub it on his back legs. Let me rub it behind his back legs, see if he's going to kick. But you notice I'm at a safe direction on the side. There was a guy that was killed. Now, see, he just lifted his leg, but he's trying to get a fly, so I'm going to help him out there. He was trying to get that fly, so I'm going to make him think that this whip kind of helps him get flies. Now, he's moving, and he's walking, and I'm rubbing it between his legs. I'm going to stick it between his legs. I'm going to get behind him and stick it right between his rear legs and kind of see if I can make this horse kick. But you notice where I'm at right now? This is a flexible whip. If I had a bamboo pole, and I did this, and a guy died doing this, he reached back here because he watched some tape or went to a clinic, and somebody said, use a bamboo stick to see if your horse will kick. So he walked behind the horse, touched the horse's back leg, the horse kicked, and this stabbed him right in the chest or shoulder area. I'm not sure if it killed him or if it injured him pretty bad, but because he didn't think of the consequences, and he was just doing what somebody told him, and said, you know what, I saw a clinician. Hi, Mr. Roper, you being a good boy? I always give a horse release and kind of acknowledge when he comes in and shows respect. He came in and faced me and kind of walked me, didn't try to push me, but kind of came in and said, how you doing? And I kind of want to make sure and give some sort of, hey, that's a good boy, kind of give him a good calm tone, let him know that I rubbed him. But the big thing I want to get back on track on, of course, I jump around because I'm multitasking, I'm worried about other horses and all this other stuff that's going on. keeping him in video and focus and trying to talk to you guys. So when you're using a stick, all that is really good. I'm going to desensitize his head. I'm going to keep him at a distance. I'm going to rub his leg. He's really wanting to follow me now. He's trying to get me to stop, okay? So now he's going back to eating. So his tail's active. I'm going to even try to stick this underneath his tail. Let me see if I can get a reaction out of him. Oh, look at that tail tuck. He doesn't like that. That, see, this rope, this has almost caught his tail. There he goes. He walked. I'm going to rub it, make it soft. There's his tail. He's got it trapped. Okay? So remember, when you're using a bamboo stick, if a horse kicks and you got it in front of you and it comes back and stabs you, it's your fault. It's not the horse's fault. I'm at 10 minutes. I got to go. Hope that helps. I'll do a part 2 on this. Good boy, Roper.